Okay, thank you, friends. After sepsis, this is also one of the bread and butter subject for all of us as a practicing neonatologist or pediatrician. When we have a case of jaundice in our hand, we usually look at them into three different prongs. First of all, we look at them on the basis of time, whether he has come early within the 24 hours or classical like 4 to 7 days or late beyond 14 days. We look also in terms of gestation by means of term and preterm babies, and also look at the terms of etiologically hemolytic jaundice or conjugational or enterohepatic circulation or what may be the cause in this particular baby. This helps us by identifying by means of time. We look at the limiting the cause and identification will be more easier. Management differs when we look at the gestation, and there will be differential diagnosis on our hand when we look at them by means of etiological grounds. So when we see an early onset jaundice, this is something which occurs within first 24 hours. The causes which erupts in our mind are usually RH isoimmunization, the ABO isoimmunization, or severe form of Crigler-Najjar syndrome, very rarely. RH isoimmunization, as you and I know, that overall incidence is reducing with invent of NTD given to mother well in time. Only 25% of those who develop isoimmunization goes into have an incompatibility sort of a severe nature, where the cord blood hemoglobin reduces, the bili is also right from the 0 hours in your hand. It requires exchange transfusion in most of them. First order birth often survives and salvages themselves because of late sensitizations. But we should also look at the specifically the history in the maternal side, that there should not be history of abortion or transfusion priorly with mismatched blood also. So that might have sensitized, and this first baby might also lead to incompatibility. Often the forgotten is the anemia, which occurs as an after effect of an RH isoimmunization or RH incompatibility, and we forget to screen these babies at 8 to 12 weeks. Whenever there is a case of RH isoimmunization, the lead message is should be that the cord blood should be best utilized. Many a times we do not know, and our obstetric colleague also forgets in hurry of delivery, and the valuable blood which can be drawn from the cord is lost, and we then have to prick the baby to get all the investigations done. Prior history of sensitization like delivery, abortion or procedure or transfusion to the mother should be known. AAP normograms for exchange transfusion are available, but if you look very carefully, there is an uncertainty in this AAP normograms in first 24 hours. Look at this AAP normogram. Here the bold lines are coming only after 48 hours. The first 24 to 48 hours, the evidence is often having a little bit of lacunas in between and little bit not clear. So this first 24 hours, where majority of our isoimmunizations of RH come into play, the nomogram is having dashed lines. So that has to be always looked at, though we can practice based upon this, but we need to take this into consideration. Indications for exchange transfusion in these RH isoimmunizations are already listed in the textbooks. I am just reciting it once again. These are cord blood, bilirubin. Mind well that these are investigations based upon cord blood. Many of us tend to forget sending cord blood investigations. Please make a habit that cord blood investigations are sent. Make your obstetric colleague consider it and collect it. Previous sibling having history of exchange transfusion and DCT being positive, a bilirubin is rising 0.5 mg per deciliter per hour. And once you have done an exchange, don't forget to serially monitor these babies, because if at the end of less than 24 hours and bilirubin is 10 or more, or after 24 to 48 hours 15 or more, or 48 hours of 20 or more, that's also an indication for a second exchange transfusion. This topic actually I have considered after having a case which was there with one of my colleague, and we had a great debate on IVIG, and that has made this topic to come in today's CME. This was the thing, that when and how much IVIG I should use in a possible case of RH isoimmunization. So what is the evidence? We have Cochrane, we have many other investigation things. In 2002, the evidence said that it prevents exchange transfusion. But present day, what we all have a consensus usually is that it prevents second exchange transfusion, not the first. Often. Second thing, its prophylactic role is always debatable. What it helps is usually the late anemias are reduced. Our own study by Dr. Piyush Chawla et al. Was suggestive that it also prevents phototherapy duration in given doses, low dose versus high dose. They found that low dose also works well in those babies. But the bold statement here is that there is no role of IVIG in ABO disease. There is no role when you are not clear why the jaundice has occurred. So make sure that IVIG is not sab dukhon ki dawa. It is for very specific use. But with a pinch of salt, take the statement that multicentric RCT experiences are yet to come on this, and being a resource limited country where our patients have always a limited settings of monetary grounds, we should have our own policy for our unit for using IVIG. This is one of the biggest evidence what I have on IVIG grounds. This is from the Archives of Diseases and a study from 2014. This was a meta-analysis from one of our friend Kiran More, who has done a fantastic meta-analysis, and he says that efficacy of IVIG is not conclusive in RH hemolytic disease. This is specifically in terms that in low risk of bias indicating no benefit, where studies with bias suggesting that it is positive or helpful will be with high risk of bias. So that has to be taken up very clearly, and there is no role of IVIG in ABO disease. So always think before you use it for RH isoimmunization babies. Often we tend to forget that NTD administration to mother is also important. The newer recommendations by AAP is using two dosages. Instead of a single dose, they are recommending two dosages. The first dose has to go antepartum at 28 to 30 weeks of gestation. The second dose comes in a postpartum phase within 72 hours, and the dose remains same for both of them. And if both are given, this reduces the risk of an sensitization to 0.1% only. So make sure habit that there should be an NTD administration. If not two dose, at least one dose goes to mother. And whenever you are giving an NTD to mother, this is going to generate a weakly positive DCT. So that should not be taken as a positive DCT and failure of NTD. That has to be taken care into mind. ABO incompatibility is also one of the things which has emerged simply because now RH isoimmunization is going down. So ABO incompatibility is one of the things which we find that day in and day out, as most of the babies who require phototherapy or exchange transfusion now fall into this particular category. And the things are okay, most of things are theoretical here. The point is that if possible and if your blood bank allows you, use O negative RBCs dipped in AB plasma. This is available, this is better and gives good results. We already have a study going on in our institute and this works out well. Prolonged or late presentation. We call a late presentation in jaundice when the baby presents beyond 2 weeks of age in a term infant and 3 weeks in terms of preterm infant. Usually these babies are well looking, thriving newborns, mostly breastfed, and we run out laboratory tests, plenty of them, to rule out usually the common causes. So what are the common causes? Usually these are continuation of isoimmunohemolysis like RH or ABO, and Crigler-Najjar syndrome can present here, breast milk jaundice can present here, and many a times idiopathic means you and I do not know. Let's talk about an example. A full-term female baby of 3 kg comes to us, all examinations and everything normal, having a icterus on sole repeated on 14th day of life, active feeding well, no history of maternal fever, jaundice, or clinical icterus is sol plus and the present weight is 2.7 kg. there was no collection of blood anywhere in terms of cephalhematoma or any other thing, and there was no hepatosplenomegaly. These are the investigations in front of you. So what would you like to do? Okay, we would go for a peripheral smear for looking at that. Hemolysis, leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, all those things. CRP is negative, TSH has been also done. G6PD activity is normal. What are the possibilities now? Okay, right. So these are the three possibilities which always remains in such cases. They are Krigler-Najar syndrome, breast milk jaundice, and idiopathic. So what should be done? Such babies, if they are crossing the limits by AAP nomograms, you should undergo for an exchange transfusion, followed by an intensive phototherapy. Baby's bilirubin was reduced to 12 after that and he was discharged. Follow-up after 48 hours was not suggestive of rise in bilirubin, but suppose it was rising, will it limit my causes now? Okay, that's the point. Okay. So here is the chart. Now again, one more thing about these AAP nomograms, that these nomograms enlist up to 7 days only. Your babies in the prolonged and the late phase usually come after 14 days in term or 3 weeks in preterm babies. So what to do? Which nomograms to use? Same. That can be used the same here, because you can stretch these lines hypothetically and use them. They are same. Prematurity and hyperbilirubinemia is also a nightmare for many of us. Preterm newborn with 28 weeks of LSCS delivery comes to us, all examinations at normal at birth, had an event of hypoglycemia at 18 hours of life, was asymptomatic. He develops a visible icterus on face at 42 hours of life, but he is lethargic since last 1 hour. When we did investigations, these were the results. CRP was 14 and the platelets were a little down. So what would you like to do? The baby has to undergo an exchange transfusion and a step up of antibiotics and NICU care monitoring all done. 6 hours post exchange bilirubin was 6 mg, and subsequently the baby was improved and was discharged home at 4 weeks. Follow-up, there was no neurological sequelae. Often we tend to forget these follow-up examinations. All these preterm babies who undergo an exchange transfusion or required a high degree of phototherapy for few days need to undergo a neurological and BERA at their 12 weeks of gestation. Friends, prematurity and bilirubin takes us to many factors to be considered. Say for example, we all know that there is something called low bilirubin encephalopathy in these babies. So connectaris occurs at lower levels of bilirubin also in them. So what to look at? Is low the gestation, the higher the chances of a neurological sequelae in these babies. But our charts which are available, say for example from the textbook of Cloharty, are based upon weight. You and I both know that less than 1 kg baby, so much is cut off. 1 to 1.5 kg, so much is cut off. So that's also need to be considered. Womb to weigh more, gestation or weight. Then there is something called bilirubin albumin ratio. We know that bilirubin is usually bound to albumin. If albumin is low, there are more chances of getting a neurological sequelae with higher bilirubin levels. So in prematurity, this is really very significant. Then some school of thought also say that the bilirubin is an antioxidant and it helps in growth and the other superoxidase injuries in these babies. So bilirubin prevents. So how much bilirubin is should be the cutoff when we start thinking of treating those bilirubin? 4, 5, what? So that also need to be taken into consideration. We all believe that aggressive phototherapy is better for neurodevelopmental outcome in these babies because we want to prevent a low bilirubin encephalopathy. But on the other grounds, there are also problems that phototherapy for longer time produces changes in the cerebral blood flow of these tiny neonates. So that also to be taken into consideration. So there is lots of ifs and buts in prematurity and bilirubin. So what to do? Well, for prematurity newborns, these criteria I have taken from Fernoff and Martin's 8th edition, which most of units usually use. Our baby was being sick, he was in 4 to 6 bilirubin, and that's why he went for an exchange transfusion. And exchange transfusion has to be carried out if the total serum bilirubin keeps on increasing even after intensive phototherapy. So what are the criteria for exchange transfusion? You can consider the exchange transfusion on this. But remember, these criteria are based upon weight. And we know that the gestation is also important, simply because your blood-brain barrier is less mature if you are having less gestation. So how much weightage to be given to these weight criteria? That also needs to be considered. Often in neonatal units, this rule of thumb is followed while managing the babies with neonatal jaundice, that we tend to go, this is an arbitrary formula, that if the baby's weight, say for example, baby's weight is 1 kg and my bilirubin levels of this particular baby will be 7.5, then this baby will go for possible phototherapy. And if he is sick and he is having even 5 bilirubin, this baby will go for phototherapy, while for the exchange transfusion, at the cut of 10, we will go for exchange transfusion if he is sick. So this is a rule of thumb usually used for a rapid judgmental things, but mind well that whose thumb is this, I don't know. Okay. There is a little solution which has come up with the NICE guidelines. These guidelines talk about gestation. So if your baby is preterm, he is having so and so gestation, you can plot. This is a computer based generated software available free online. You can download it, you can fit your all the details, put the gestation, and they have a plotted graph for you. And this graph can be applied to the particular baby situation, and that will give you a nice judgment. This graph looks like something this, and your baby's plotting might be falling in somewhere, which you can see and take your judgment. Now, talking about the aggressive versus conservative phototherapy, what to do? Because there are always two school of thought. The point here is that the rate of neurodevelopmental impairment alone was significantly reduced by aggressive phototherapy. But when you combine this with the possibility of a death, it does not significantly reduce. But following the normograms and following the criteria, there is something to offer on this, and aggressive phototherapy is something what is used by most of the neonatal units. Bilirubin albumin ratio we have talked. So these are the AAP guidelines to follow in this particular things with babies of different gestations. The point here that a recent BAR trial, this was in 2014, a randomized controlled trial, which was the largest trial said to be bilirubin albumin ratio wise. The conclusion was that additional use of bilirubin albumin ratio in management of hyperbilirubinemia in preterm infants did not improve their neurodevelopmental outcome. Means looking at bilirubin albumin ratio do not alter your patient's sequelae in this particular areas. Let's talk about what the major chunk is. Term baby in the classical timeline means coming after a 48 hours going to first 2 weeks of life. Often we fall into the trap of the age-old phenomenon of pathological versus physiological. Often the PGs are asked questions, which is pathological jaundice, and he mugs up and says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So does it really carry important? One of the real good article on this in pediatrics was a commentary by Maisels, and that said that what is in name? Ultimately you are going to treat or not treat. So that's what is important. So don't fall into the pathological or physiological. Defining the severity is more important, and most authors and researchers agreed that in even terms, the TSB, which is considered to be an hazardous, would be at the level of 30 milligram per deciliter. So what should be your approach in those babies who are more than 35 weeks falling into this classical phase? First of all, we'll define the severity and we'll do a risk factor identification. Then we will go for the will subject these patients to AAP nomograms or NICE guidelines or whatever you are following in your unit, and will treat accordingly and investigate based upon our clinical diagnosis and clinical presentation of the baby to define it and label it a perfect diagnosis. AAP guidelines, properly popularly known as Bhutani charts, the AAP nomograms, these are the guidelines for phototherapy initiation and continuation. These are the guidelines for the exchange transfusion. You and I both know, not going into detail. But the modern world is all about apps. So how can I complete without talking about apps? So one of the online resources which is available for your computer, desktop and the mobile is BillyTool. BillyTool is available for iPhone usually. So most of us sitting here might feel that, what about Android? So looking for the Android, there are plentiful of apps now available. These are the apps which are available in front of you: Billy app, Billy Cal, then phototherapy, phototherapy calculator, and Billy Guru. I will be talking about these two apps principally, which, because I have gone through all the apps and I have find out that there are two apps which are really important. They are free. First of all is Billy app. This particular Billy app looks like this. When you download, it gives you all parameters to put into. Say for example, you have put your baby is of 30 weeks, you have entered the gestation, the date of birth and everything, and then finally you enter the levels of bilirubin. This particular app talks in terms of micromoles per liter. That's in UK standard. But it's no big deal. If you multiply your bilirubin milligram per deciliter by 17.1, that gives you a micromoles per liter level. So that's there. Then we must feel proud that an Indian has also developed an app. That's Billy Guru. And this is something like Tech Guru and many other things. But this is really a nice app. Specifically, this is very concise. And what interests me more is that it gives you two different values, like applying a milligram per deciliter or applying also a possible micromoles per liter. So this solves the problem for me. And fortunately, both of them run on the NICE guidelines. So that gives you an edge to work it over in preterm babies, term babies, all equally. So that is good thing. So let's look at the Billy app. The Billy app gives you something like this. When you fit the data and ask for what should I do, it gives you an interpretation about the things. It gives you the action to be taken in this particular baby. And this really is helpful, specifically because it gives you a chart. These charts are looking like this, and your baby's progress is already been stated here. So this is very easy to operate, very easy to understand and apply. And if you are not familiar with this, this is already I have talked that if you want to convert this milligram per deciliter to micromole, the multiplication factor is 17.1. Okay. Then treating the unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia, the treatment modalities remain same. We are not going into details, except that there is currently no evidence supporting the use of metalloporphyrin, phenobarbital or clofibrate. So that has to be taken into consideration. We already talked about IVIG, phototherapy and exchange transfusion is something what we should not discuss on this dais. Regarding the different phototherapies which are available in front of us, different things are there. LED is something which is nowadays in most units used because of the very simple reason that it gives a very high irradiance. Specifically, the central beam which lies over the baby is really high, up to 30 microwatt, and that's really something. It gives a low power consumption, cost factor is also an issue, and more importantly, we must come out of our old mindset that phototherapy, whenever given, it raises the ambient temperature and it leads to a good insensible water loss. That has to be come out when we are using these LEDs, specifically because LEDs are cool light. So your baby is not going to be that hot. Your baby is not going to lose that much insensible water loss. So adding always a 20 ml per kg of fluid in those babies who are under LED phototherapy might not hold truth. Okay. Rest of all the things are well known. I'm not going much into the details. then what makes the difference while giving phototherapy? For all of us, we agree that babies who need to be given phototherapy should be using a blue light spectrum of what, 30 to 490 nanometers of that thing. Then the central beam of this should usually be of 30 microwatt per centimeter square of nanometer of flux. This has been the recommendation by AAP, and believe me that this signifies and stays true only for the LED phototherapies. The peripheral phototherapy rays should be 4 microwatt. This occurs with all, there is no issues. If you want to give more intensified phototherapy, take your baby closer to the light source, and if he requires more, then double this by giving it from the undersurface as well, and you can use them. Then the question of whether the CFL is best or LED, the two research papers which are available, from one of from our Indian Pediatrics, second from the ECTA Pediatrica, both suggest that there is no great difference by means of using them by clinical use. So thank you very much for patient hearing. This is also available on the Easy Pediatrics. You can send your feedback. Thank you very much.